Production Studio. Video. Photo. Digital Imaging. Presents.
We've got an introductory video prepared by Arishad, Mohammed's long-time friend. It's taken a lot of effort and time. This event came together after the announcement that I heard on the radio. And I phoned Joe, I'd like to call Moosin while he's answering his phone now. The announcement has just been made and you're already not taking calls. But anyway, he eventually called me back and explained why he couldn't talk to me. And Jomo and I had a chat and I said to Jomo, you know, let's organize something for Moose. I think he deserves it. But I think we as a community are proud of his achievements. We are proud of who he is and what he is. And we want to say a very special thank you to the Moosajee family. To Mohammed's parents, to his wife, who has been a big part of his success because he couldn't have done it without her support. So I'm going to hand over to Arishad, who will introduce the presentation and sit back and enjoy it the rest of your evening and have fun.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and distinguished guests. Firstly, I'd like to thank one and all of you for gracing this occasion with your presence in paying tribute to Mohammed and his wonderful family. When Jack and Jomo asked me to do this, initially they wanted me to give a speech. Initially I I was so delighted and so privileged. I felt so privileged. And when I sat down to pen my thoughts, you know, Mohammed and I go back 36 years. It's a long time. We share a great friendship. And I sat down and I started penning my thoughts. And it was just so much to write about. I made a couple of notes. And, I don't know where to begin. So anyway, I decided that what I'm going to do is do a video presentation, because this comes from me. I'm always on the other side of the camera. And Mohammed, I hope this is going to be something that will be memorable for all time. And you know, like they say, life begins at 40. I know you're not going to be here with us, but what better place to celebrate your birthday? The home of cricket will be at Lord's. We wish you luck in the new endeavors. So I guess all I have to say right now is concentrating on this video. So without much further ado, I trust it will all sit back, relax, and enjoy this video journey in paying tribute to a gentleman that I've known and admired all my life. Thank you.
There are moments in time of incredible bravery and heroism. There are moments in history when a few brave men and women stand up to be counted. Here they draw the line and say they will stand and fight. Their stand may be small in comparison to the great battles in which thousands perish. Yet perhaps they achieve even more through their spirit, courage, and determination. When principles hold fast against huge and overwhelming odds, no matter what the outcome, victory is theirs. The Mohammed Moosajee legacy is one such moment in time. Tonight, he has won our hearts and we are very happy to share the special occasion with him. You see, Mohammed and I have had many adventures together over the years. As my closest friend of 36 years, I probably know him better than most. So I racked my brain trying to think of a story I could tell that wouldn't shock such a select gathering. All I can say is that Mohammed is a wonderful friend, always there when you need him, and that he is the soul of generosity. Mohammed Abdul Samad Moosajee was born to Rashida and Abdul Samad on the 16th of July 1968 and is a product of Lanesia. As a toddler, he played his sport in the backyard of his flats and as a teenager in the open park near his home. He always achieved top honors at school, coming out first in class from grade 1 right until standard 8. In standard 9 and matric, he was among the top 3 of overall students. He was nicknamed Moose in 1983, and this is the name by which many know him. Moose attended Wits University in 1987 and qualified with his pharmacy degree 5 years later with a prize in pediatrics. He further went on to qualify as a doctor in 1997. As if that was not enough, he furthered his studies in sports medicine and qualified in 2001. All of us at some time or other have wished for a secret genie or fairy godmother. We would like to rub the magic lamp and have the genie of our wishes appear. Who hasn't at some time wished that scenario a part of their lives? Most of us, though, have dismissed such fairy tale adventures as fantasy or wishful thinking. Yet wishful thinking might not be so far from the truth after all. Don't some people seem to have all the luck? We are not just talking about lottery winners, but those who seem to glide from success to success in life. They are not just the wealthy, but the blessed, the healthy and happy, they who seem to be fortunate and content in whatever they do. They may be in the minority. After all, life as we know it is not that way at all. It is hard and filled with struggle. We lurch from crisis to crisis. Wouldn't we like to have their luck? Wouldn't we like to know what their secret is? What if we could borrow their magic lamp, even for just a little while? Today, Mohammed Moosajee has added another score to the scoreboard of life. He has survived another year with all its happenings, its problems, and its blessings. Today, we are all gathered here to celebrate his appointment, and quite honestly, it's a bit like being at a cup final. There's a lot of excitement, noise, and goodwill. In other words, all his supporters are gathered here to cheer him on to the next year of fresh endeavors. If we judge Moose by his past achievements, he will undoubtedly be fit and raring to go into the coming season. When I say Moose is sporting, I mean it in the broadest sense of the word. There's not a mean bone in his body. He never cheats or fouls, or at least not when the referee and umpires are looking. Be sure to be sworn at if you are not playing his game. His behavior is always that of a sportsman and a gentleman. People like Moose are rare these days, and that's why we are making such a fuss of him tonight. Moose may play one position in his sport, but in our lives, he plays many parts. He is a teammate, a husband, a father, a family member, and a good friend. More than anything else, Moose has a wonderful sense of humor. He can laugh at himself too, which is one of the reasons he is so popular. He likes people, and it shows. He can keep a confidence better than anyone I know, and he does good the way it should be done, silently and without fanfare. He has great leadership qualities. In his lifetime, he has played many games. He lost some and won some, and accepted each result in the same sporting spirit. He knows excellence doesn't come easily, but is prepared to work very hard at it. He may never win an Olympic medal, but he has won many hearts.
Mohammed Moosajee, who's from Sporting Cricket Club, that's a cricket club here in Lanasia, here in Joburg. And maybe just to begin with you, Mohammed, you guys just recently went on a trip up to Malawi. I know you had a choice of either going to India or to Malawi, and you chose to go to Malawi. Now tell us a little bit about the reasons behind that.
Well, basically, our executive set with the idea of going on a cricket tour. We decided to go initially to India, but then we spoke to Hussein, who was working with development in Africa. And he thought that it would be actually beneficial not only to the development of the game, but to cricket in Africa, to actually go to Malawi. Mm. And that's why we ended up in Malawi.
Okay.
Did you guys end up coaching the boys too? I mean, did you just play cricket or what did
we,
you guys
We played
do?
Five competitive games, and we had two coaching clinics from grassroots level. Mm. In fact, one of the days we had about 400 school children with 60 teachers, and it was very well attended. The talent is obviously there, it just has to be nurtured now.
I'm Mohammed. First and foremost, I think you've seen the media release itself. I think we all are excited about your new appointment. It's a really highlight in your career. And I think you really deserve the honor. First and foremost, I think, just to tell people where it's coming from. We, first as Cricket South Africa, and we were not happy with the applicants. You as my boss, one of them. I then reported back to you as my bosses that these are the kind of applicants we got and they do not fit the profile of the person we're looking for. I was then given a mandate by the board that I must go and headhunt suitable candidates for the job. As you know yourself, it was not easy to find a suitable candidate for this job, because it's a seriously onerous position. Being a humble person yourself, I think some people must have spoken to you and approached you and asked you to apply for the job. I don't know who those people are, but I'm thankful that you have accepted that, because I do not believe there was a better candidate than you. So I want to say to you, Mohammed, whatever people say, I really believe this job was destined for you. It was meant for you. I'm sure you are going to be a successful manager. Within the panel itself was unanimous in the decision. You are an intelligent person. It was difficult for me in the first place to interrogate you as my boss in the interviews, but you were so humble. You subjected yourself to the process. Being the humble person that you are, with all the achievements that you've had. I've known you since 1986 as a 16-year-old when you started playing for Transvaal. in the olden days. I think you scored most of your runs against our team, EP. If I'm correct, I think you scored in your debut 86 against us, which was your highest first class score. And most of your runs, as I said, were against us. You seem to enjoy our bowling. But with all of that and our friendship has been, first and foremost, you've been a good friend. You've respected me as a colleague and a friend. And again, now you are my boss, but you never showed that you are my boss. You never acted like a person as my boss, but you subjected yourself to the interview panel and you got the job. I'm also aware that your parents are celebrating this special moment, and I want to say to them as well, what a nice role model to have as a son. They must be proud parents. You've shown your true colors as a student. You are a top student. You are a bright, intelligent person. You are a brilliant board member, a good cricket administrator. You've got it all. It's your choice. You've got a good practice going on, but still your heart is with cricket, and I know that. And you have devoted yourself for the next 3 years to serving this game, and I thank you for that. Good night.
Well, Mohammed, this is a change of events, me having to talk about what you do. I think your accomplishment being selected as the manager of the South African team is fantastic. It's another feather in Gauteng's cap that one of our people are now going to hold that very prestigious position. I think you deserve it. From all accounts, from what I understand on feedback from the players and management over there, you are a person who listens to what their needs are. However, you are firm when you need to be. With regards to your position here in Gauteng cricket, you've certainly added a lot of value. You're a man of principle and you stick to those principles, and that's what makes good administrators in cricket, and those are the kinds of people that we need to have in cricket and in sport in general. I wish you everything of the best, and may you go from strength to strength. Cheers.
If the convener of selectors does not reflect what he's adhered to, then as chairman, I will never accept the team and he goes back. And if he can't do the job, then we find somebody else. And coming back to the national setup, I think this has been the core of the problem. There is a policy in place, it's been reflected very clearly to you. If the convener and the selection panel feel they can't abide by that, then as far as I'm concerned, find somebody else. Coming to the second point, and this is where I disagree with our team vice president now, who said that all the unions have a duty themselves to see that the transformation policies and other things should be carried out. Now let me tell you, I come from Gauteng. 9 or 8 years ago, there was policies that were developed by Cricket South Africa that needed to be followed through. For those policies to take place, you need the world to change. In Gauteng, it never changed until 2 years ago. There was a huge fracas and a walkout because there was no world to change. Now I'm sorry, it cannot happen from top up. It has to happen from top down. That's where you need the custodians of cricket, who is the general council that sits here, that need to dictate to people at lower levels to say, listen, if you're not falling into line with our policy, then these are the ramifications. My last point, and this is slightly different, I've been close to the team, the South African national team, in the sense that I've been the team doctor for the last 5 years. And maybe I talk now from a point of, how can I say, preference, in that a lot of what's happening at the moment, as far as I'm concerned, is based on fear, the fear of the unknown. The coach, he has this fear because maybe his contract is performance-based. The white players in the team, they have fear for transformation. Why? They might lose their position, and somebody else that gets the opportunity who might be black will replace them. And generally, we all have the fear for change. So I think if we don't address those problems in the new South Africa, in the new Cricket South Africa, in the new Proteas team, in 5 years from now, we're still going to have the challenges, because you're always going to have people not trusting each other.
If I personally had to choose a person to be manager of the Proteas, Mohammed would have been my choice as well. I've got the greatest of respect for him. I've worked with him for the last 3 years. He has been our team doctor. For those who are not aware, I haven't lost my job because Mohammed is on board already almost a year ago. We had a temporary manager, Logan Naidu. Basically, the structure within the national team is becoming so big that we had to look at the various ways of getting a lot of other people involved, and my role has changed somewhat. I now would specialize in logistics, and Mohammed and I would complement one another, and him being the manager obviously would be also a board representative. So we have an added advantage going forward. Mohammed basically is a person, essentially very pleasant, soft-spoken, and to a large extent very similar to me. And I have found him to be an honest broker. We have been friends of the field, and that also will help in terms of moving forward. And all I would like to say that, Mohammed, I wish you everything of the best. You deserve to be where you are. What a pleasure when you look at it that I'll have my own family doctor traveling with me right around the world. So that I hope, Doc, you not only are a manager, but you better make sure that you got your doctor's bag with you, because your patient is going to be standing next to you all the way through. Having done this thing for 14 years and been driven by a passion, what is very nice and comforting for me is to know that the man who's taking the post as manager of the national team has also got a huge passion for the game. And that in itself, you can't buy that in a supermarket. You know, people do certain things either with a passion or without one. And I know you from the one that has a passion for what he does. Otherwise, you wouldn't be giving up your practice. You wouldn't be coming and touring right around the world knowing that you have a successful practice. But sometimes it's not just about money. It's about what drives you, what makes you tick. And I know cricket makes you tick. Maybe we got something in common. I gave up pharmacy 15 years ago. You, I'm not saying giving up medicine, but you have made a choice. And from a selfish point of view, I think you've made a brilliant choice. Thank you very much for coming on board. And I really, really look forward to having you. And together, hopefully with the coach, we'll have one of the strongest management teams that the Proteas have had. Thank you. Good luck to you. And may Allah be with you throughout and make it easy for you.
Mohammed, my good friend, my peer, my colleague, my medical doctor, and my brother. It has really been a wonderful experience in having made your acquaintance. I recall you, and I believe I was still the captain of the Transvaal, as it then was, cricket team, and I handed over to you a trophy when you were 12 years old, and you were the most budding cricketer in our province, if not in the country. You know that you could have played cricket, soccer, perhaps even rugby at any level, if you were given the opportunity. Not only were you an outstanding sportsman, but you were a great, conscientious and principled leader in the form of an administrator. You were my vice chairman over many years in the Gauteng Cricket Board. For the contribution that you made, for the assistance that you rendered, and the support that you gave to me in such a principled and a conscientious fashion, I can never express or articulate my gratitude. You're a good human being, and God Almighty has blessed us to live in the in an era together where we could associate with each other and share each other's friendship through good times and through bad times. I wish you well in your voyage as a manager for the national team. You are a proud ambassador of this beloved country of ours, and I have no doubt that you will put us in good stead, as you have in everything that you have done throughout your endeavors in all of your life. Good luck, my brother.
Assalamu alaikum. Congratulations, Moose, on your phenomenal achievement. I think, you know, for us that has known you for all our lives, we're so proud to be associated with you. I think not because of your excellent achievement, but you as a human being. I think all our lives, your compassion, your willingness to help, your desire to be a friend, has set you apart from a lot of people. I think, you know, we grew up in an environment where every day was a challenge, and I think that just gives us the drive to be successful in whatever we want to undertake. But I think you epitomize where we all desire to one day achieve, to put back in our community, but also make a success of our lives. And you have done it. I think many people have spoken about Moose the cricketer. I want to talk about Moose, first the sportsman and then the friend. Moose the sportsman. I know not many people know this, but I think there was a time in many of our lives that we could have diverted to many different fields of sport because of the talent and the hungerness and the coaching we received by a number of people. And then there's no different to you, Moose. I think if you had gone into the football field, I think you would have made a success of it. Volleyball, you would have made a success of it. Athletics, you would have made a success of it. It was just that all-round ability that always came through. I think, and also your leadership skills are excellent. From a very young age, I think it was recognized by a number of individuals. You know, we were fortunate in our growing days that we had the likes of Mr. Bismillah. Many of us know him as Sir. The likes of Louis Juvenanta, Mansoor Abdullah, Ismail Kolias. That gave us a home to express our skills and talent. And you know, there was a time I think we just missed one another and playing in different teams. But when we got to play, I think it just showed the greatness we achieved. An example is the Lesko team we had, as you can remember. Forsberg City team, and just to mention a few. But and then I'd like to just touch on a small side of Moose the person. I think your compassion, always your availability, and even now with your success, it hasn't changed you as a person. And I want to commend you. I think it's wonderful to know that, you know, you saw, you know, many people change, but you haven't. And I wish you, your family, everything of the success. You deserve everything you've achieved thus far.
Mohammed, you and I have always been very, very close. There's a 3-year age gap between us, and notwithstanding that age gap, you've always been apart from being a big brother, a great friend to me, and I've always seen you as a role model. You've excelled academically and you've excelled at sports, not only at just cricket but at soccer, volleyball. Even I remember at high school days you were throwing the shot put and the javelin. And you had a special talent, and it was never a question of me being jealous of that, but rather looking up to you. And I knew I could never match those special talents, but I could always be proud of the fact that I had a brother that had those special talents. And I'm now very proud of the fact that you've been appointed the South African national team manager, and I wish you all the luck in your new position. Well, Mum and Dad were, I guess when we were young, we saw them as being too strict at the time, but now we appreciate what they've done for us. I think what we can now sit down and recognize is that when we were much younger, even though they were very, very supportive, they always knew where to draw the line, and that's helped us all become better people, and we are very appreciative of that.
Let's talk a little bit about Moose, and there are many facets to this man who we honor tonight. But let me begin by reminding you of the saying that children learn what they live. So I will begin, and I know I do it for everyone present, to pay tribute to Muhammad's wonderful parents, Uncle Abdul Samad and Auntie Rashida, who groomed Muhammad to what he and his brothers have achieved today. As a community, we thank you for sharing your gift with us. Let's not forget that behind every successful man is a very hard-working woman. Muhammad's extensive travels and commitments outside of his practice requires tons of sacrifice. And here, his lovely wife Hamida has given the type of support that allowed Doc to attain so many accolades. Well done, Hamida and kids. I warn you that this is only the beginning of better and more successes to follow. How do you pay tribute to such a young man? These types of evenings are generally held for people who are in the August of their lives, having been there and done that and achieved success or contributed to society. So what is it about Moose that is so special? From a young age, he set out to be an achiever, academically and in sport. These were and still are the two primary areas where he was influenced by his parents and his friends, who all played sport. But Moose was different. He was disciplined, he demanded the same from his mates, and commanded respect. He always believed in himself and instilled this trait in his teammates. He led from the front and invariably created winners. Let me share two anecdotes. His popularity as an empathic physician stretches far and wide. And how many of you know that once in India, a lady who was a member of the ground staff suffered an epileptic fit and rolled down a few stairs? Moose's quick reaction saved her life, and the incident made headlines the next day. I know Jack and company can share the funnier and naughtier moments, but I witnessed Doc stop an after-match cool-down session in Kanpur one at the end of day's play during a test match in India. The team were playing a game of soccer and it was haphazardly arranged. Doc stopped the whole game, picked the two teams, had the bibs put on one lot, and then allowed the game to continue. No one bothered to stop him, and everyone paid full attention, very much like his schoolmates and his junior teams too. Oh yes, he was in one of the teams, and boy, he took no nonsense, as was in fact the loudest on the field. What great respect he garners wherever he goes, and this appointment, which was largely influenced by the players, is perhaps truly the ultimate accolade that one can acknowledge. Like Ghulam Raja, they are in their respective positions because the players would have no one else. Best of luck, Mr. Manager. The challenge ahead is immense, and we are confident that you will do all of us proud.
Many years ago, Moose, the late Reggie Fountain, told us that he recognized your leadership qualities. Moose, as a doctor, I find you quite dedicated to your work and really admired by your patients. As a friend, I must tell you, I really value your friendship. I think you're quite genuine, loyal, and honest. Always generous, and you'll always go that extra mile. A few years back, we had a soccer game, over 35 game, at the Lanesha Stadium. And there was some altercation, it broke up into a fight. Nonetheless, the following day, the word went around, and there was one lady who got to know that there was a Dr. Moosajee that was involved in a fight. And she was arguing with people and saying that this could never be my doctor. My doctor is too gentle, too kind. You could never ever get involved in such things. But that's the side of Moose. When he plays the game, he plays it hard. He gives it 100%. And that's what we know Moose of. As a son of Lanesha, I think we're all very proud that you've achieved this milestone. Coming from our community, I hope that we don't only see people as managers, but people like you who has dedicated so much to the sport, also playing for the national team. I want to wish you well. I think that you deserve it. More importantly, I want to thank Femida. Femida, I think you're making a great sacrifice. I know it's tough. fact, when Moose asked me whether he should take the job, my only concern was about the family. But I'm sure you guys will work it out. It's a sacrifice, but it's also an honor to our community and our nation. Thanks.
Moose, my buddy, you do us proud, and we're all happy for you. On a lighter side, I hope these guys know what they're in for, because you're a hell of a taskmaster. Us boys, Chops, Chomo, and the old guard. Thanks, Moose. All the best.
Congratulations. As a family member, you make us feel very, very proud.
Mohammed, we as the Moosajee and Mayed family are proud of your achievements in every level of what you've endeavored to achieve. Firstly, your achievements academically, secondly, your achievements on the sporting front, how you excelled playing numerous sports, which included soccer, cricket, squash, even rugby. The main qualities that have allowed you to achieve all your dreams has been your persistence, your dedication, your discipline to achieving whatever you wanted to achieve, your ability, firstly, academically, to be able to play sport on a weekend and still go in and write an exam the next day was fantastic from that point of view. Your abilities and your qualities that have allowed you to be accepted in the sporting front and in the sporting world amongst maybe 15, 20 professional players, and the fact that they accept your opinion and value of your opinion. On the sporting front, you've excelled from a very young age. Your ability to lead by example was always the best quality that you possessed. Growing up, obviously, as a younger brother, I've always looked up to you and your achievements to such an extent that I even ended up following the same career path. I pretty much played the same sports as you did, and obviously couldn't match your achievements, but anyway, tried to get there anyway. On your career path, your ability as a medical practitioner, your ability with your patients, the amount of time, amount of care that you give your patients is obviously been proven to no end. On a more lighthearted note, this wicket has been definitely a batsman's paradise. Now we're moving to more a seamer's wicket at the Wacker. I think we need to relook this partnership and relook at my package. On a more serious note, I wish you the best in your future endeavours with the South African cricket team. We know you've done a fantastic job already, and we trust that you'll continue to do a fantastic job in the future and continue to do us proud.
Assalamu alaikum, Mohammed. I hope you're well. I just beamed through on Harry's camera from Cape Town, and unfortunately, Shaila and I could not be here tonight with you. But our duas are with you. It's just an honor and a pleasure to have lived with you, grew up with you, and spend a lot of quality time in school and on the sports field with you. I've been very fortunate to play under your leadership. And wow, I've got enough swearing. I mean, unbelievable. Both Harry and I, you know, drop catches, and we were so scared. I mean, we weren't scared of our parents, but we were scared of you. But nevertheless, I mean, we learned, and that was the most important thing. You were always willing to share, and share your ideas, and share your leadership abilities with us, and with me especially. And alhamdulillah, today I am in a leadership capacity at work, and I'm very fortunate that a lot of stuff I've learned working with you and playing with you, I use today in my professional life. I wish and pray to Almighty Allah, inshallah, to give you your heart's desires and make you as successful as ever you want to be. And wish you all the best with the Protea squad and for the future. Shukran.
Moose, at the time of this appointment, and I know you probably you'll still be going through the processes of finalizing details, but I want to personally congratulate you and tell you how very proud I am of where you are today and your success and your achievements. And for me, there's no better person than you that could have gotten this post. I know you're going to be successful, and I know it's going to be difficult, and you're going to have to see through all of those with the same temperament that you've approached everything that is challenged you in your life, whether it be personal, whether it be cricket, soccer, your medical practice. I know you went through a bit of a tough time with your attempted hold-up at your surgery, and it's going to be difficult, but you have got what it takes. You have got the grit, you've got the determination, but you've got everyone's blessings. You've got people supporting you, you've got their prayers with you constantly. It is all of that, what you've given to us, is what we can give back to you at a time like this. And say to you, we will always be here for you. We are absolutely proud of your success. And we know you're going to be the best that you are in what you do. Femida has also played a very big part in all of where he's reached, because a partner is exactly that. It's someone who lends support, who supports your decisions, who gives you the space and the freedom to follow your passions. And Moose is absolutely passionate about everything he gets involved in.
Asking me about something about Moosajee. He's been with our academy since the start. He's our chairman. I've never found a better person. He's very supportive. He's helped us through a lot of things. And the most important thing I would like to say about Dr. Moosajee is he's there for the underprivileged children and the poor people. He helps them a lot.
I've known Dr. Moosajee through the academy, and he's currently our chairperson of the executive committee. I know him to really have been somebody to have been giving back to the community. He's really assisted the underprivileged in the sense that he doesn't really charge anybody. And at this stage right now, we'd like to wish him well in his new endeavors.
Dr. Moosajee is our academy doctor. He played cricket with my father for many years. He's a chairman of our academy. As you can see, we are doing quite well. We wish him well as the manager of South African cricket and in all his future endeavors. We wish Mr. Dr. Moosajee very well. Thank you.
Moose, my friend, my doctor, my brother, and as I call you, uncle, congrats on being manager of the best cricket players in South Africa. Let me tell you, I am really disappointed that Harry interviewed me last, because I am not a number 11 batsman anymore. Uncle, our friendship developed on the cricket field when I recall you played your first game against Eastern Province in the South African Cricket Board. You hooked Jeff France for 6. From that point forward, you consistently played provincial cricket at the highest level during the apartheid era. To me, honestly, you were the hardest captain I've ever played for. I know you always demanded 110% whenever we played. But let me tell you, boy, if you misfield, drop the catch, you would hear some musical words from Mohammed. I promise you, these words you don't even hear in his practice because you can't preach them. This is very emotional for me. But I'm coming clean. If you were my captain, when I bowled those few wides, I promise you I would have bowled twice as much as wides that I bowled that day. On a more serious note, while you were captain during a bully ball fixture, you came in with your team being 76 for 8, and you scored an unbeaten 103, which led your team to victory. That was a phenomenal performance. Doc, you were captain of the school's team at Lanesia, and then promoted to captain of Transvaal High Schools, and then got the highest honor at school level, being captain of South African school's team. That was the greatest achievement at that time. As a person, what you have accomplished in life doesn't compare to the respect that everyone has for you from all walks of life, from the cricketers, to the administrators, to your practice, and to all around the world. And I believe you will do justice to this new challenge, inshallah. Uncle, on a lighter note, as a youngster, I know you are a strong Amandla boy. Between you and I, this is. You know, our friendship stretches far, 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 far back. During the apartheid era, you never, ever supported South Africa as a cricket team. And now, I have a question for you. I'll leave it as that.
Ladies and gentlemen, the Proteas' new team manager, Mohammed Moosajee.
To Mohammed, and also to meet old friends and, as you've been doing for most of the night, play a little catch up. Our first speaker for this evening, and I know he's not going to be impressed with me for doing this, but I have to. He hails from our midst as well. He played for Crescent, captain Transvaal, and then moved on to cricket administration. All of this was accomplished in tandem with his legal career that was already reaching successful heights. He served as chairman of Gauteng Cricket Board, and you all will remember the famous walkout. Mohammed, you should remember that best. Mohammed played under his captaincy, served on his board. At present, he is a High Court judge and professor of law, and serves on many other organizations, far too many to mention. Ladies and gentlemen, may I introduce to you the Honorable Justice Mohammed Jajbai.
Who would have known that I would have met this Krish, my own buddy, for so many years from legal fraternity again here, to see Dr. Saluji and his lovely wife, Auntie Sarah, to see Ismail Badi, to see Ibrahim Badi, the Bapala brothers, the Dokra brothers, Ashraf Kolia, the Moosajee and the Maya family, Bosa, his name is Bosa, left his son. Yes. I mean, I just want to take everybody's name here, but I can't do that. But I acknowledge everybody here. The fact that you are here just fortifies my belief in this community. And all the things that we struggle for to come to this stage makes it all worthwhile. Now, my talk can be for the next 10 minutes, or I can say, Arshad, you did a great job, and all that the speakers say, I agree. I could do that and just go and sit down. But being the nature of this night, this evening's presentation, I think that would be unwise. Particularly to Mohammed, your lovely wife, Amida, your daughters, your father, your mother, your uncles, and all of us, your friends. You know, not nice things have been said about our lawyers these days. Now, just want to share some of my... We begin to hurt. Reputation begin to hurt. Now, Amar is not nice. I'm sure there are other lawyers here as well. Somebody asked, how many lawyer jokes are there? And in response to that, they said, just two. The rest of them are all true. That's not nice. And somebody was asked, what's the difference between a lawyer and a trampoline? And they reflected and then said, well, you take your shoes off before you jump on the trampoline. Well, you know that feeling. Yeah. And then somebody wanted to know, why don't sharks attack lawyers? I say, it's professional courtesy. What do you have when a lawyer is buried up to his neck in sand? Not enough sand. Yeah. Sometimes, maybe small children can take that one. What do lawyers use for birth control? Mom is a doctor, he should be known. What do lawyers use for birth control? Their personalities. Oh, my brother's a lawyer too. That's what can I say? Well, I can understand why Americans think of cricket as an odd English game. Every time I see cricket sports news on CNN or any other channel that doesn't understand the game, they usually show a batsman who's wearing a helmet and who is fully guarded and fully padded. Then this fellow who's batting is facing up to some very gentle spin bowling. It makes cricket look like a slightly more dangerous version of crochet. And another thing, what's the point of playing a 5-day game when all of it ends in a draw? Silly people, I don't know why they do these things. What makes cricket so interesting is the multitude of factors which go into each game. First, there is the time. 5 days. So you can easily spend half an hour planning your strategy. Then you can have a pitch. That's that little rectangular spot that you find in the middle of the ground. Cricket must be the only sport where things wear out intentionally. The pitch becomes ragged and worn out by bowlers running up and down on it, which influences the bounce of the ball later on in the game. The ball itself wears down as it is bowled and hit. This influences the way it flies through the air and the way it bounces on the pitch. Unlike baseball, the ball is allowed to bounce before the batsman hits it. The players also get worn down as the game progresses, testing their stamina and concentration. Cricket must be the only game where it is perfectly acceptable to bowl the ball at your opponent's head. Now to the serious stuff. Being present and seated in this glass house, one cannot resist traveling through the annals of time. There are so many memories. Whilst we're reflecting on the memories, let's think about some of those who have contributed for us to celebrate this achievement tonight. I think of my very good friend, Dr. Abu Azhar. I think of Dr. Rajiv Feldman. I think of Isubai Kara. There are so many people who have been here. I haven't mentioned them, but they're all in our thoughts and our prayers tonight. Truly they are. Some of the memories are pleasant, and others are truly shameful and painful. As a community, we have made great strides in the administrative spheres. Some of our achievements include Mr. Harry Norbert, who is now the Chief Executive Officer of the International Cricket Council. My good friend, Kassim Suleiman, and I believe he is here somewhere. Where are you, Kass? Are you here? You didn't run away, Kass? We're very proud of your achievements, Kass. Kass is the Chief Executive Officer of Africa Cricket. He's bringing cricket to children of African origin throughout our magnificent continent of Africa. Kass, we're really proud of your achievements. Really. And for what you're doing. And we, you know, we hear what you're doing now in Algeria, and in Egypt, and in Libya, Morocco, all over. We're proud of you, Kass. Then, of course, unfortunately, Ghulam's not here. Ghulam, who's done a sterling job as the national manager. He's the logistical manager now, Ghulam Raja. And now our own Dr. Mohammed Moosajee, who's the manager of the National Cricket South African team. And I'm sure I've left out some of the people. I don't do it intentionally. On the playing field, there is much to be accomplished. However, Indonesia Cricket Club's achievements this season are noteworthy. This season, Indonesia Cricket Club was voted as the most improved club at Gauteng. The best all-rounder was from the Indonesia Cricket Club, as well as the best bowler. Now, I urge on the administrators of the Indonesia Cricket Club, let's get some players in the provincial teams on a regular basis. We need to ask ourselves, why don't our children play for our provincial and national teams when there's a rich tradition and a rich culture of cricket from our area? It's time that we address our minds to these issues, and our children should be playing both in provincial and national teams on a regular basis. When we honestly ask ourselves which person in our lives means the most to us, Mohammed, we often find that it is those who, instead of advice, solutions, or cures, have chosen rather to share our pain and touch our wounds with a warm and tender hand. The friend who can be silent with us in a moment of despair or confusion, who can stay with us in an hour of grief and bereavement, who can tolerate not knowing, not curing, not healing, and face with us the reality of our powerlessness, that is a friend who cares. That, my friend, is you. The celebration of Mohammed's appointment as the manager of the national cricket team is no ordinary celebration. I speak this to your family as well. It is a day when all of us need to pause and reflect on the past, to remember the heroes and heroines who brought us our freedom and opportunities. Those whose sacrifices made it possible for all South Africans, black and white, to enjoy the benefits of democracy, and for all of us to prosper. Let's never forget those contributions. If we are to salute their collective memories, we ought to bear in mind that the richness of South African life arises from the multicultural society we have. Our diversity in language, culture, and religion is our strength. Regardless of whether the contribution comes from citizens or from immigrants. Please pay particular attention to that. Whether the contribution comes from citizens or from immigrants, we need to respect that contribution. I have known Mohammed for about 30 years. I recall the industrious student, the talented cricketer, the political activist, having obtained degrees in pharmacy and medicine. He has now graduated into a loving husband, a caring father, and a dedicated medical practitioner. In between all of his duties, he remains a principled administrator, a friend, and a leader with enviable qualities. To us, who have been fortunate to know this gentle giant, we are impressed and inspired by his vision and capacity for critical thought, by his genuine humility, and by his unassuming manner. His commitment to the cause of the people and his unselfish determination to do everything possible to further that cause helped keep alive, even during the most difficult days of dissension and disharmony, the traditions, the culture, and values of the aspirations as we continue to seek and implement. I really got to know Mohammed, the sports fanatic, senior administrator and doctor, through different stages of life. My friendship with him may be described as many years of graceful but forceful forensic stroke play. Jack, you may appreciate this. My friendship with him may be described as many years of graceful but forceful forensic stroke play, which has delighted those privileged to bask in the glory of an inspired innings against sustained periods of hostile bowling in the boardrooms, cunning spin in debates, and skillful googlies in trying to create opportunities for less privileged cricketers, very often in conditions of adversity and corroding unleveled playing fields. In Mohammed's company, you will learn that there is no substitute for rigorous internal democratic debate. He will constantly remind you that every member of a collective must be free to express his or her views without fear or favor. These are the special qualities that stand him in good stead with the players and fellow administrators at the Gauteng Cricket Board, as well as the national cricket team, where at critical times, I know for a fact, the national captain will quietly canvass his views on difficult issues. There were many times when Graham Smith went up to Mohammed and he talked to him, not only about cricketing issues, but about personality issues, psychological dynamics, and many, many others. And we saw how Mohammed tendered assistance to a woman in India, and he saved her life. I didn't even know that. It's the first time it came to my attention. But I'm not surprised. That's the kind of human being this fellow is. Where at critical times the national captain will quietly canvass his views on difficult issues, these are the qualities that have been recognized by Cricket South Africa and have justly rewarded him as the national team manager. Mohammed's elevation to his high post is an exciting time for all of us. Truly, Mohammed's elevation to this high post is an exciting time for all of us. It shows that all challenges can be conquered. We salute you this evening, my good friend. You are an outstanding role model, a committed activist, fearless administrator, and a caring medical practitioner, compassionate and lovable man, and above all, you are a noble and sensitive soul who has grown immeasurably taller in the very act of giving of yourself. We congratulate your parents in raising you, and thank you, lovely wife Femida, for allowing us to share in your valuable time. I have no doubt that the national cricket team will appreciate your immeasurable value almost immediately. A wise person once said, your friend is that man who knows all about you and still likes you. Your friend is that man who knows all about you and still likes you. I can call you my friend. Once more, congratulations and good luck.
Thank you, Mohammed, for those very profound, thoughtful, and funny jokes as well. Okay, a little bit of light entertainment before we carry on. Typical Indians, okay? It reflects on all of us. There's this barber in London that has the most beautiful haircuts. No head massage like we get here. He hasn't learned that yet. And a florist goes to him one day, gets a haircut, goes and pays. The barber says, no, I'm doing community service, I don't charge. The guy leaves the next morning, thank you card, dozen of roses on the door. Happy. Policeman goes, the same story, refuses to charge. Next morning, thank you card, dozen of donuts. Barber's happy. Here comes Babu Bai. Babu Bai's going for a haircut. Software engineer, very smart, snazzy guy, he goes for this haircut. Same story, barber refuses to charge him. The next morning, the barber opens his door. What do you think he finds? A dozen Indians for a free haircut. Yeah. He started his career at Action Ball Spurs, I don't know whichever one you prefer to call it. Followed the path of cricket administration after unification. At present, he serves as a double CEO, Eastern's Cricket and Africa Cricket, also the Regional Development Manager of Africa. Ladies and gentlemen, Cass Suleiman.
Assalamu alaikum and good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Well, representing Africa, you know, it's going to be a long speech, I presume. It's one of the biggest continents in the world. First and foremost, for the new generation that don't know me, basically, I was a guy that came from Malaysia. The carpet players, that most of them are sitting here, long before Ken Packer and started acting on Spurs, and we played on one national cricket out here in Indonesia. And I know, Mohammed, when you were around, we had all those candles lying out in the road here. I think that's some fond memories. Basically, I'm not going to be very, very long because I know most of you are hungry by now. I just want to firstly thank you for giving me this opportunity to attend this gathering. It gives me great pleasure to address this auspicious occasion this evening. I'm excited and delighted with the appointment of Mohammed Moosajee as a new team manager of the South African national cricket squad. The second successive person to serve this position from this region, that's Indonesia. Mohammed Moosajee has been a team doctor for the past few years, and his passion is second to none for the game. He excelled in football, cricket, volleyball in the 1980s. This experience and knowledge would stand South African cricket in good stead. Although the post of team manager differs from a team doctor, I'm sure that he will approach his duties with the same passion as he has done so far. Mohammed was a fine player who later became a successful professional doctor in his humble background from his days in Indonesia. He has helped to develop the next generation of players from the previously disadvantaged communities. He is usually respected and well-liked by all. Mohammed is very knowledgeable and passionate in the cricket matters. He will have a most positive impact in his new post. Finally, his contribution to the establishment of the unity in cricket was most meaningful, and his legacy continues to live on through the generation of cricketers in Indonesia. Mohammed and I have a very close cricket relationship, even at this present moment. We share a lot of ideas, either on the phone or whenever we meet abroad. The experience and expertise that have been exchanged were well utilized in the upliftment of the game. I, together with all of his admirers and all that are present here this evening, wish him well and know that he will represent our community proudly. And before I end off, obviously I've been instructed by my board, by the chairman and the executive committee, seeing that Mohammed's bosses are the affiliates of Africa Cricket Association, they asked me to give him a gift. And that gift is a well-packed travel gift, and I think Hussein should know. Hussein, they do have some musical aspects in it. So basically, being an African, and this is from Africa, we'd like to present you with something. Could come forward to please. And this will obviously help you in your travels right around the world. Thank you.
Thanks, Cass. Just a little something we need to take note of, and this is for all the men out there. You need to pay special attention to this. There's only a woman that can raise a doctor, a world-class athlete, and an A-plus student in a society deemed dysfunctional, broken, and disenfranchised. Only a woman can do that. And for all you married people out there, a good marriage is one which allows change and growth in an individual. Both these things are reflective of the marriage of the doctors, Moosajee. Femida has always been supportive of Moosa's sporting endeavors, which thus allowed him to be really successful in this field. She's been the cricketing widow more than I think she cares to remember. taking care of the home and family while Mohammed has pursued his dreams. This little gift that we have here tonight is a token of our appreciation to Femina for allowing Mohammed to be part of the great wide cricketing world. Femina, does he name Suruji? Rosie and Nango? You can bring her with you. And talk a little bit about parents. I think parents are the backbone of society. And it's through them that we learn morals, values, and just how to live a proper, wholesome life. Mr. and Mrs. Moosajee have reared three exceptional sons. I'm not going to say which one's better. I'm not risking that, not a chance. Their wonderful upbringing and values instilled in them are loudly evident. It speaks for itself through years and years. And their successes, the successes of all three sons, bear testimony to the home they come from. And on behalf of all of us that have the privilege of dealing with your sons, we'd like to call Mr. and Mrs. Moosajee as a token of our appreciation as well. Who knows Nelson Mandela, then you know you're really proudly South African.
Somebody was telling me a bit about I'm too pro-woman. I wonder why, you know? So let me tell you a little bit about the wily nature of women. And gentlemen, you need to pay attention, eh? You need to learn. Okay, this guy Dan found out that he's going to inherit a fortune when his father passed away. Sickly father going to pass away. And he thinks he's going to get a lovely, beautiful woman to enjoy this money with. So he goes to the singles bar, he sees this drop-dead gorgeous woman sitting there. He goes to her and he tells her, I look like an ordinary man, not much to talk about, but in a few days, maybe a week or two, I'm going to inherit $20 million because my dad's about to drop dead. This woman thinks, this sounds good, impressed. She goes home with him that evening. And 3 days later, she became his stepmother. So watch out, guys. Our next speaker, ladies and gentlemen, is a truly remarkable young lad from Malaysia with extremely outstanding cricketing ability. He started his career at his first. He moved on to LCC, Malaysia Cricket Club. He enjoys his sport, and it's definitely evident in the successful season he's had this year. He has captained LCC for the 2020 competition and been afforded the honour of named GCB's Player of the Season 2007-2008. He also has another interesting accolade about to be bestowed upon him, and that is he's about to become Judge's son-in-law. Ladies and gentlemen, Ziad Ehsan.
Thanks, Anna. Our first cricketer encounter with Moose, also known as Clark Holloway, was a few years ago when I was about 14 years old. I was still playing at the Sporting Cricket Club at the time, and I just happened to be fielding at Mudlock. The opposition had headed to about 50 foot 2, and the batsman decided to sky one towards my direction. I got under the ball, positioned myself nicely as I saw it rise for the bright blue sky. I was cool and calm as usual, until I heard the mighty words, "You better catch them, ball or else." I'm sure everybody here knows exactly what the words were, and I don't have to put it in any uncertain terms. Needless to say, I fumbled the ball a good few times and eventually caught that red curhead. It was at that stage that I realized the pressures that would come with playing senior cricket. It was no longer a joke, but something that needed to be taken very seriously. Every wicket was important, every ball was important. I also had the pleasure of touring Malawi with Doc, and there I learned something which not many of us would have seen. Doc is the type of man who puts on a brave face, he's fearless, he's a warrior as everybody has described, and he has a never say die attitude. But let me tell you, he's got a fear and a big phobia for deep waters. We were supposed to get up to our little rowboat and get across to a small island where we were going to spend the day. And for love or money, we couldn't get Doc onto this boat. We threatened to leave him behind, and that was the only time we got Doc on it. Moose first started off as a pharmacist, as you all know. I'm not sure many of us know where he practiced first up. It was in Hillbrow. I was still a youngster, but I remember it clearly. He also had a passion for medicine, and when the opportunity arose of him studying further, he grabbed it with both hands, showing once again his determination to succeed in whatever field he pursued. He has also gone on to become the South African cricket team doctor, the doctor for Kaiser Chiefs, and as we all know him, our very own doc. Moose has shared his playing cricket days with many other talented individuals. Usain Bolt, who's here with us today, Nazir Dinda, Jack Manaf, who's also here with us today, and Iqbal Khan, to mention a few. These players all had tremendous cricketing potential, and it's a great tragedy that not one of them went on to succeed and play cricket at a higher level where they could have truly shown their ability and potential. For various reasons. It would be a great shame for us sitting here if the community allows history to repeat itself with our current crop of players and future players to come. I have no doubt that amongst our current crop of younger Asian cricketers, we have the ability to produce players of provincial and international test quality standards, provided they are given the deserved opportunities, support from us, the community, and also the shared knowledge from our senior statesmen, many of whom are sitting around here today. I'd like to see you guys at the cricket grounds, sharing that knowledge with the youngsters so they can achieve what we have not. It is a time for us as people to start making some changes. Let us start working together as a community. Let us be a united force. And let us change the way we treat each other. The old way obviously hasn't worked for us. So it is up to us to do what we have to do to take the nation of cricket forward as a cricket force in Gauteng and South Africa. I recently attended the GCB Awards evening not too long ago. I was pleasantly surprised to see that many people's dreams will begin to become a reality. Out of all the awards presented on that evening, about 75% went to non-white cricketing teams. It is only now at the top level that we need to start dominating and making our matters right. This, in my opinion, is only a matter of time. But it will need the help of everybody sitting here and the support of everybody here. Moose's rise to cricket, this cricketing pinnacle was not without problems and without hurdles. There were many long evenings which were spent strategizing, planning. It went on to about 3-4 in the morning at times. Many of these great plans were written on the back of a green and white consulacy red box by none other than Uncle Jomo himself. The result, Moose was elected as a board member. Doc is a hard and fierce competitor, and he wouldn't give you an inch unless you truly deserve it. I believe that his attitude towards life is best summarized by these few words. Impossible is just a big word thrown around by small men who find it easier to live in a world given to them, rather than change it. Impossible is not a fact, it is an opinion. Impossible is not a declaration, but a deed. Impossible is potential. Impossible is temporary. Impossible is nothing. Moose, you are truly an inspiration to us all, and every member here of the Asian community is truly proud of what you have achieved. We'd like to enjoy your successes with you from now and into the future. You have shown us how to uphold one's values, stand firm in our beliefs, stand for what is right, fight against oppression and wrongdoing unto others. You have shown us how to be proud and at the same time humble. You are an exceptional leader, but I speak here on behalf of myself and I'm sure many others. You are an even better friend. Doc, we wish you all the best in your appointment with the South African cricket team as a manager, and our only hope is that the next representative for the South African team will be from Indonesia as a player and not as an administrator. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, before we continue, there's a little token that was sent to us from SuperSport to be presented to Mohammed. Azhar, if you could kindly do the presentation. We have no idea why it's in here, Moose. You can share with us afterwards. We have this Kaiser Chiefs manager, Moose would know him because he was their team doctor. And he flew to Baghdad to watch a young Iraqi play football. Okay? Very impressed, brings the guy over to South Africa. 2 weeks later, Chiefs is playing SuperSport, ironically enough. And there's 20 minutes left and Chiefs is catching a hiding. They're 4-0 down. So the manager gives this Iraqi guy a chance and he goes on. And he's brilliant. Okay? And he scores 5 goals in 20 minutes and they win. And everyone's happy, and the media is going wild. And he player comes off the pitch, and he phones his mom in Iraq. And he tells her about the South African football, and he says how well they did. And his mother is not too impressed. She says, oh, that's all good, you know. She says, but let me tell you about my first day here. Your father got shot in the street. He was robbed. Your sister and I were ambushed and assaulted and everything else that goes with it. Your brother joined the gang of looters, and all of this, and you scoring goals. So, I mean, why do I feel good? And he's upset, and he says, I'm really sorry, mommy. And she says, sorry? It's your damn fault we moved to Johannesburg in the first place. This noteworthy gentleman started his cricketing career at Three Lords. He moved on to Pirates, had a stint at Crescent, played for Spurs, Sporting, LCC, represented Transvaal under the CAD days, was involved in a stadium shutdown, and you'll know what we're talking about there, and played soccer for Bluebells, was involved with Lesco, and then moved on to administration. Served on the exec of Sporting and LCC, elected to the GCB, albeit on the back of a consulate box, served as selector at Gauteng, appointed as vice chair of Gauteng Cricket Board, chairman of Strikers, currently the chairman of the franchise, the New Heights Alliance team. Appointed the National South African team doctor for Kaiser Chiefs, involved in numerous humanitarian organizations that not many of us even know about. Moose and his wife assisted in Afghanistan, aiding people involved in the xenophobic attacks, and many people don't know about it, but I think that's the way they like to do it, and that's the way it should be done. Tonight, ladies and gentlemen, we are all here, myself and everyone else that's involved here. We have to applaud all of those achievements, and especially the most current one, that of general manager of the South African national team. As you've heard earlier, and you know, to put into many rumors, he's not replacing Ghulam Raja, who's the logistics manager. Mohammed will be working in tandem with him. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm extremely honored and pleased to introduce to you Dr. Mohammed Moosajee, known to all of us lovingly as Moos.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I begin in the name of the Almighty, whose guidance, grace, and mercy we seek today and always. I don't know if I'm humbled or if I'm embarrassed, but sitting here tonight, it's almost like an out-of-body experience. You're watching people say good things about you, and yeah, to a certain extent it makes you shy, to a certain extent it makes you proud, but when you're sharing it with people that are close to you, you don't really care. I grew up not far from here, as many of you know. You know that I'm the eldest of three brothers, and we used to live in a place called Top Shops. And we were crazy about sport from a very young age. So much so, that I'll tell you a secret. Myself and my three brothers used to play cricket and soccer in my bedroom. We had our own version of indoor cricket, which used to drive my mother nuts. I can't tell you how many cupboards we broke, how many windows we broke, and how many tennis ball marks we had to wash out for punishment. But having said that, and to explain how passionate I was about sport, I can remember forfeiting a final year exam in my second year of pharmacy to play in the final of a Transvaal under 21 team that was under Lucky's Bismillah at the time. And you know, I repeated the whole year for it. I hope my mother and father are not listening to this. My Baba was reminding me how I was writing my final pharmacy exam, and we were playing a provincial game somewhere, and in between I had my books in the dressing room, and I was trying to, you know, learn a few tidbits, go out to bed, come back, try to feel, and do the same thing. And then there was a time where I drove 1400 kilometers from Cape Town with my close friend, the late Hassan Gengat, and we came back for a league decided, it was a soccer game, Lesko playing Forsberg City. We both played on opposite sides. And let me tell you, we both got sent off in the first half. Now, as you know, it wasn't the first time that I got sent off. And I mean, on the field, as Yad said, I was very competitive. Often, I won't say making enemies, but not being the favorite of many people the way I played my game. But let me tell you, off the field, sports to me was the vehicle to build bridges of friendship that we see today. It created everlasting friendships. And if I look around the hall, the room tonight, what better place to spend an evening like this to make it so memorable than people that are so close to me. We have amongst us people that have played and administered the game at the highest level. We have talents and we have the abilities, and we need to utilize this in every possible way. Tonight might be about recognizing an individual, but for me, it goes beyond that. To me, it's about celebrating a community. And you should all, we should all feel proud of this. Because let me tell you, you have all helped me in my personal development. Where did all that begin? For me, it began at home. As somebody alluded to earlier, I grew up in a very orthodox religious home. My father was extremely strict, but let me tell you, he was very supportive of both my academic and my sporting career. So much so, when I finished pharmacy and I said, I want to go back and study medicine, a lot of people dissuaded me and said, ah, you will be an old man when you finish and go out there and earn some money. But he was the guy that supported me financially and morally, and he was not at that time, he had two other sons to put through university. So with all that, I had a mother on the other hand. She was an absolute star, totally devoted to us. She was firm and fair, and she was a disciplinarian. And I never used to get reprimanded or punished in the form of a beating or hiding. If they wanted to punish me, they just did one thing. They prevented me from playing sport on the weekend. Now that to me was torture. I would have rather taken the hiding, but not to play soccer or cricket on the weekend was absolutely unacceptable. My gratitude goes out to my parents, who instilled in me the rich values and the value systems that I grew up with. This gave me meaning, it gave me purpose, and it gave me a direction to live my life. We were fortunate, and I'm sure my brothers would concur, to have had such a solid upbringing. We were truly blessed. Mom and Dad, I say from the bottom of my heart, I salute you and I love you. So what lessons have I learned over the years? And most of it I've learned from people that are sitting here. And to me, there's seven core values. The first one was the value of friendship. Let me tell you, there's guys in this room that I would go to war with, and I thought they'd do the same for me. I mean, there's guys that with over 30 years of camaraderie, guys like Jack, Arishad, Zahir, the late Hassan Gangat, Chops, Jomo, Nassim. I valued your friendship, and I'll be proud that you associate me as a friend, and I call all you guys my brothers. The second lesson that I've learned over the years is that of discipline. And it started at home based with my parents, it went on with the teachers, and then it went on to a lot of my coaches. And whether you liked him or hated his way, someone like Bikis Bismillah, unfortunately, is not here tonight, actually taught me a lot. I remember Senator 8, vice captain of South Africa, Transvaal Schools, playing in the tournament in Paul, opening the batting, getting out to a really loose shot. And what he did the next day, he dropped me, he made me bat number 9. He made me bat number 9 just to teach me a lesson. I scored 35, the team did well, and the next game he allowed me to go back and open. I scored a century, and that's how I made the South African team. And I think it's small lessons like that that have taught me that how important discipline is in our life. The third aspect is the aspect of humility. For those of you who knew the late Hassan Gangat, you had the privilege of meeting him. He was a really wonderful person. And he was as humble a human being as you could find. I really do miss him. And then there's Ghulam Raja. Let me tell you, that man is an absolute legend at what he does. He was so humble as the way he accepted me into the system. But I will tell you, if it wasn't for him, I would have never accepted this position. I'm not replacing him. 15 years ago, when Ghulam was in charge, he was responsible for the media, he was responsible for logistics, as well as administration. The way world cricket has changed, today you need a strong management team. And what's happening now is that you have a separate media officer. You need someone who's very focused with logistics because of the amount of travel there is. And Ghulam's brilliant in that. And mine is going to be more as an executive or an administrative position. And I'll be supporting the management team. Yes, the responsibility of discipline and team morale and policies and procedures of Cricket South Africa is going to fall under my domain. But I don't see myself as the be-all and end-all of the team. I see myself as part of an important cog of the management team. The fourth aspect that I'd like to talk about that I learned over the years was that you always grab your opportunities. As an 8-year-old, I used to go to the cricket ground there with my uncle Mohammed, and I used to ride school. I used to pray that somebody gets injured so I could do finding duties from one side to the other. And at the age of about 12, I think I got the opportunity to play a game. And it gave me so much courage to play against grown men as a 12-year-old. And you know what? These men, in certain ways, showed me the cricket skills, they helped me prepare mentally. And from a 13-year-old, I could find myself playing senior cricket. So I thank you, Uncle Mohammed, for that. The fifth is that you should always display respect. I mean, you know, I played cricket with many people. And if you look at the guys like Abu Manak and them on the field, they were like 40, 50 years old when we were youngsters. But they treated people with respect. I had captains like Munir Saleh, Judge Bryan, all these guys. They taught you how to deal with people. Yes, maybe when I dealt with people, it was differently. I was sometimes vulgar and abusive, and I apologize for that. But it was just that I hated losing so much. But as we matured, I've learned from that as well. The sixth aspect that I think is very important in my development is that to trust your skills and to back your abilities. As a 15-year-old, making my debut for Transvaal, the late Bhai Raja was my captain, and he came up to me and he told me, go out there and play like how you play. And that's exactly what I did. I didn't change anything. I played my game. I didn't care what was bowling on the other side. And I think it holds for international cricket as well. When you sit in the dressing room with some of these master, seasoned batsmen, Jakar is almost reaching 10,000 runs. But when you see their concentration and the nervousness in some of them, you can understand that we can all go through it. It happens to every one of us. And the last point I want to talk about specifically as far as values are concerned is that you should always listen to good advice. I mean, I've listened a lot to and I value what Mohammed Jajwa has to say, my brother Aslam, but they're typical lawyers, you know, so they're very analytical about things. But there is some sense in that as well. But one person who's always been a mentor in my life, and I think he's the person my wife should hate and should love, as Bimantha Jamil, who's also sitting here tonight. He's always guided me, and I think it's important when you make important decisions in life that you don't just tongue suck, but you speak to people. When I wanted to marry my wife, I spoke to him, and he gave me the permission. So, Pamela, you should actually acknowledge it. But when I took the job as manager, I went back to him, realizing that family and practice and everything is going to be sacrificed. But he gave me advice again and said, take the job. So, hate him without me. With opportunities, there also come sacrifices. And obviously, I think my family and my practice have bore the brunt of this. To my dear wife of 15 wonderful years, I want you to know that I think you're an incredible person and you've got huge courage. I value your forthrightness and your honesty, and you will always be my pillar of support. Remember that my success means nothing with your support, and I thank you for all your sacrifices. My children, Fatima, Aisha, Amina, and Zahra. The next 3 years will be quite challenging, but I promise not to neglect my fatherly duties, and I will be there for you guys at all times. As far as my practice is concerned, most people have heard or felt that I'm giving up practice. That is not so. My arrangement with Cricket South Africa is that whenever I'm in the country, I still will be in my practice. But again, my support structure has been excellent. I would like to acknowledge my brother Ibrahim for handling the load in my absence. I know it can be very daunting and demanding, but I do appreciate it. I would like to conclude by personally thanking everybody for attending tonight. It did catch me by surprise, I must tell you. I didn't expect this in my wildest dreams. I must thank people like Jomo, Azhar, Shamina, Rahima, Shahana, and Arshad for organizing this. And finally, my gratitude goes out to the Almighty for granting me the privileges and the opportunities that He has in my young life. Jazakallah.
More than that, ladies and gentlemen, I can't say. I can't drop that, I'm sorry. We're almost at the end. I told you, we reward you. We have speeches, we reward you with food, dessert. I didn't lie. But before we get to that, there's just two little things we need to do. As normal, the vote of thanks, and as a, you know, you've got to do something as well, so don't be shocked.
I'd like to call upon Sherina to do the vote of thanks.
Thank you, Shania. Assalamu alaikum. I am here to thank everyone, first of all, for coming here tonight and making this a success. And I think it speaks volumes for Moose on just the presence of all of you today. And first of all, I would like to thank each one of you for being here, and I think we owe ourselves a hand clap. Then on to formalities. When we started off this evening, we had Ali Mehta giving a prayer and thanking the Almighty for everything that we have. We conclude by thanking all of you who are creatures of the Almighty and who carry those values that have been inculcated in us, to be humble, to give off. Because without giving off, we would not be here today. To Papa Joe, Jomo, who has made a great success of this event by putting his hands in his pocket and asking other people to contribute, and all of those, all of you who have contributed, I say thank you very much. All of you that feel that you need to contribute, please speak to Jomo. Thank you so much for that. I go on to thank the Moosajee family for giving us this opportunity. To Mohammed, thank you so much for giving us this opportunity. We are so proud of you. Thank you. To Ashad Sitar for the brilliant video. You've taken us down memory lane. Thank you. To the Honorable Mohammed Jajbai. To Kasim Suleiman, Sia Desai, to HRN. To Rahima Sheikh and Shahana Suji. To all the waiters here today, to the Mehta family, and thank you to everyone. Thank you so much.
I thought of God here. Nonetheless, I want to thank everyone for attending. This whole function started off by a phone call from Rahima before me, and she felt that we should do something about the appointment of Moose as the manager of the South African team. You know, with people like Rahima, Shahana, Sherina, you know, I have very little to do. I think the success of this evening was definitely, I want to thank them. Rahima, Sherina, and Shahana, thanks a lot. I just want to... Rahima, could you just come here? This is a token of appreciation, eh?
Proceedings for this evening. Dessert will be served at your table. Tea, coffee, and little niceties are in the foyer. Kick back, relax, bond, enjoy. Thank you for being here, and please drive safely if you're out of place.